SoFloRadioOrNot.com and SoFloRadio.com present The Nicole Sandler Show.
Truth to power, baby.
And now, here's Nicole.
Good morning. Welcome to a Tuesday. I am Nicole Sandler coming to you live at RadioOrNot.com, SoFloRadio.com, TalkRadio1.com, and ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. Lots of ways to listen. Hopefully you'll find one that works for you. And of course, the podcast is always available after the show, free of charge, whenever you want to listen to it. However you do, I thank you for listening. If you tune in early, the Ustream feed at RadioOrNot.com and on Talk Radio 1, I play some pre-show music. And most of the time, there is a theme. And today it was freedom. You think on the surface here in the U.S., we are a free society. But when you get down into it and you really look at specifics, no, we're not. Pre-show music today was If You Love Somebody, Set Them Free by Sting. Tyrone Wells with Freedom. Graffiti 6, awesome new band with Free. People Got to Be Free, going way back to the Rascals. And then Neil Young, Rocking in the Free World. And all of those songs are pretty much dedicated to our first guest, who will join us in about 15 minutes, Don Siegelman. Now, if you listened to, I guess, hosted the Randy Rhoads Show last week, and on Friday, was it Friday? Friday. I had Don Siegelman on the show. And if you don't know the story about Don Siegelman, then shame on you, because you haven't been paying attention. We'll get into it in a few minutes. And Don is going to be with us for most of this hour. So you might want to, if you have friends who need to know about Don Siegelman, get him over here. All right, because they need to hear what's happened to this man, what was done to him. The situation he's in is not of his own doing. It's got nothing. Well, he was targeted, but again, we'll get into that in just a little while. Before we get there, I do want to deal with this Todd Akin nonsense. Why all of a sudden the world, this country, is surprised that there's a teabagger out there who is, who basically demeaned people, women who've been raped. Why are they surprised? I don't get it, because they have been at this for a while. Let me just read to you from Think Progress from yesterday afternoon. Paul Ryan and Todd Akin partnered on radical personhood bill, outlawing abortion and many birth control pills. I mean, this is nothing new. Maybe it's the fact that Todd Akin said it so clumsily, and I guess for that we should thank him. But here, on Sunday, Think Progress reported that Todd Legitimate Rape Akin, and GOP vice presidential candidate Paul Ryan both co-sponsored the bill that introduced America to the despicable term forcible rape. You remember that. It was back in February of last year. Sorry, all rape is forcible, right? As it turns out, this may only be the second most sweeping attack on reproductive freedom that both men partnered on. Ryan and Akin also co-sponsored a federal personhood bill called the Sanctity of Human Life Act of 2009, which declares that a fertilized egg is entitled to the exact same legal rights as a human being. From that bill, one, the Congress declares that, A, the right to life guaranteed by the Constitution is vested in each human being and is the paramount and most fundamental right of a person, and B, the life of each human being begins with fertilization, cloning, or its functional equivalent, irrespective of sex, health, function, or disability, defect, stage of biological development, or a condition of dependency, at which time every human being shall have all the legal and constitutional attributes and privileges of personhood. Oy. And two, the Congress affirms that the Congress, each state, the District of Columbia, and all United States territories have the authority to protect the lives of all human beings residing in its respective jurisdiction. Holy shit. Think progress continues. Lest there be any doubt, this bill is unconstitutional. Congress does not have the power to overrule Roe versus Wade by an ordinary statute. Only a constitutional amendment can serve that purpose. Moreover, even if Roe were overruled by the Supreme Court, Ryan and Aiken's bill still attempts to redefine who, quote, the right to life guaranteed by the Constitution, end quote, applies to. Again, changing the meaning of the Constitution can only be done through an amendment, not through an ordinary act of Congress. But the fact is, these pieces of shit want to tell you that, abortion is illegal, even in the case of rape and incest. It doesn't say it in those words, but they're saying that... the life of each human being begins with fertilization. Cloning, or its functional equivalent, irrespective of sex, health, function, or disability, defect, stage of biological development, or condition of dependency. Lovely. Lovely. Now, if that wasn't enough, you think, well, the Republican Party today is trying to push this off as sort of a one-off, right? As sort of, well, this is an anomaly. This is, oh my God, this is, the Republican Party. This isn't indicative of the whole party. Well, it is indicative of their platform. You know, the Republican National Convention begins next week in Tampa, Florida. By the way, it looks like they might get hit by a hurricane. Just saying. this from today's Tampa Bay Times. Actually, it was yesterday. The buzz at the Tampa Bay Times has obtained a draft of a section of the platform that delegates will vote on next week, titled Restoring Constitutional Government. The 8-page document offers a snapshot of the current state of American conservatism. Now, it's only a draft, and the platform committee must approve it before the full Republican National Convention votes on it. But here are some excerpts from a document that serves as a guidepost for Mitt Romney's presidential campaign. You ready? Now, I just read to you about the amendment that they can't do the personhood thing unless there's an amendment to the Constitution. Human Life Amendment. Wow. Here you go. We assert the sanctity of human life and affirm that the unborn child has a fundamental right to life which cannot be infringed. Can I just say, if it's unborn, it's not a child, it's a fetus. There's a difference between the two. A child is something that walks around. Even a baby is not, well, I guess it is a child, technically. Anyway, here you go. We support a human life amendment to the Constitution and endorse legislation to make clear that the 14th Amendment's protections apply to unborn children. We oppose using public revenues to promote or perform abortion or fund organizations which perform or advocate it, and will not fund or subsidize health care which includes abortion coverage. Abortion is misspelled, by the way. There is no explicit exception for rape or incest. Yeah. And it goes on from there. But I thought that was pretty telling. That from the in progress, in the works, GOP platform. Lovely. No exception for rape or incest. That's how they really feel. Okay? I don't care what Mitt Romney tells you. That's how they really feel. Now, okay. Yesterday, Todd Akin went on Mike Huckabee's show. Apparently, he stood up Piers Morgan on CNN because he knew he wasn't going to get the softball interview that he wanted. So he went on Mike Huckabee's show. Yeah. And here's a little bit of it. Yeah, I can't make this shit up.
Congressman Akin, thank you for joining me, because I know it's a very difficult day for you, but you're getting hammered out there, and I wanted to give you an opportunity to explain what did you mean by the comment that you made yesterday?
Well, Mike, I really appreciate your program and everything
of course
you stand
he does.
For.
Because
and I
you'll
really
give
appreciate
me a softball
you
interview.
A chance to try to make this thing right, because I've really made a couple of serious mistakes here that were just wrong, and I need to apologize for those. First, I might say that I've always been committed to pro-life, and it was because I didn't want to harm the most vulnerable. But likewise, I care deeply, for the victims of people who've been raped and they're equally vulnerable, and a rape is equally tragic. And I made that statement in error. Let me be clear. Rape is never legitimate. It's an evil act. It's committed by violent predators. I used the wrong words in the wrong way. What I said was ill-conceived, and it was wrong. And for that, I apologize. I'm a dad of two daughters. I want tough justice for the sexual predators. I've always had a compassionate heart for the victims of sexual assault.
Really?
I've even known some women who have been raped.
Oh, my God.
I know that it is
he
a
knows
terrible,
some women
terrible
who have been
thing.
Raped.
That those
wow.
consequences extend many, many, many years later. I also know that people do become pregnant from rape.
And no.
I didn't mean to imply that wasn't the case. It does happen.
Really?
And
you didn't mean to imply
terrible,
that.
Particularly the most terrible
wow.
of all. And I really... just want to apologize to those that I've hurt because, as I said, I have spoken in error. I wanted to get that straight right off the
bat. I have spoken in error?
Well, there has been a firestorm from this, and I think one of the problems that maybe accelerated it was the use of the term legitimate. What did you mean by
listen to this
legitimate
one.
Rape? Were you attempting to say forcible rape?
Yeah, you were attempting to say forcible rape because forcible rape is so much more acceptable.
Well, I was talking about forcible rape, and it was absolutely the wrong word.
Is forcible rape. Can I just say that's enough of that nonsense? Because all rape is forcible. You know, what that is in reference to is a bill that Todd Akin and Paul Ryan and most of the other members of the Republican caucus in the House actually passed in the House in 2011, last February, and it redefined rape and basically said, you know, forcible rape. So any like 13-year-old who might be, coerced into some kind of a sexual relationship with an older man, that's not considered forcible rape. If a woman is drugged and rape, that's not considered forcible rape because the woman doesn't fight back. Seriously? And now they're trying to make it so that forcible rape is okay, to use that term is okay. It's not okay to say legitimate rape, but it's okay to say forcible rape? Give me a fucking break. And then, to make matters worse, and I love this, I actually love this, Todd Akin put his a TV ad up yesterday. You ready? This is the guy who wants to be a senator. He's running against Claire McCaskill from the state of Missouri for the U.S. Senate. And this is the ad he's running now.
I'm Todd Akin, and I approve this message. Rape is an evil act. I used the wrong words in the wrong way, and for that I apologize. As the father of two daughters, I want tough justice for predators. I have a compassionate heart for the victims of sexual assault. And I pray for them. The fact is, rape can lead to pregnancy. The truth is, rape has many victims. The mistake I made was in the words I said, not in the heart I hold. I ask for your forgiveness. I'm Todd Akin.
That's his ad for a Senate run? I ask for your forgiveness? Oh, my God. Well, apparently, under Missouri statutes, I guess he's got until 5 o'clock today to pull out of the race. Apparently, this guy's ego is so huge that he's not going to. And I say, good. You know, hey, the people of Missouri nominated him to run against Claire McCaskill, and I think he needs to see it all the way through. What a piece of shit. All right, let's leave it at that. We'll get back to it, I'm sure, in the second hour when Gotta Laugh joins in for the discussion. In the meantime, stick around. We're going to take a very quick break and come back on the other side with Governor Don Siegelman. If ever there was a travesty in this country, a travesty of justice, this is it. His story is it. So stick around. Don Siegelman joins us next.
Fracking is a deeply grave concern. Literally. Hear about it today on Hightower Radio. Such energy powers as BP, ExxonMobil, Halliburton, and Koch Industries have gone crackers over fracking. Seeing huge profits from this dreadfully destructive and dangerously dirty method of forcing natural gas out of rock formations deep in the earth, the industry is presently scurrying all over the country, asking landowners to sign contracts, allowing them to drill and frack on farms, parkland, playgrounds, and even people's backyards. But now, in cities and rural areas alike, this unbridled gas rush has become a matter of deeply grave concern. literally. In the shriveled ethical universe of these fracking profiteers, money trumps everything and nothing is sacred. Not even graveyards. The eternal resting place of our loved ones. Yes, gas frackers across the country are out to get drilling rights in hundreds of cemeteries, promising maintenance money to caretakers in exchange for letting the corporations sink their explosive siphons down under the dearly departed. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust, and mineral rights to Exxon. How spiritual. Oh, come on, snap the industry's impatient hustlers. The fracking takes place way underground, so it won't disturb the graves. Yeah, but what about the souls? A cemetery is a spiritual sanctuary, a place of respect, serenity, and moral decorum. But a fracking corporation has no soul, and its moral concerns penetrate no deeper than its bottom line. For a measure of just how shallow corporate morality is, note that the frackers even threaten the hallowed ground of some of our veterans' cemeteries. Their ethos is clear. Hey, out of the way. Decorum is one thing, but there's money under those graves. This is Jim Hightower saying they're fracturing our deepest values. To fight this, go to foodandwaterwatch.org.
If you'd like more of Jim Hightower's real populism, check out the Hightower Lowdown. Jim's monthly newsletter gives you the real lowdown on which corporations, by name, are doing what to the middle class, our environment, and our democracy. Each month, the Hightower Lowdown brings you facts you didn't know, along with actions you can take to fight back. It also comes with a sense of humor. Hightower believes we can fight the gods and still have fun. Plus, get this, it's cheap. Only $15 brings you 12 issues a year. For real populism, go to HightowerLowdown.org.
You never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to the Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com.
Alan Grayson, you're the best. We love you. We need you back in Congress, and I'm here to do whatever I can to make that happen in my own little way.
Thanks. I enjoyed the time with you personally. I wish that the listeners could get to know you the way that I know you and understand that you're the same person off the air as you are on the air. It's not some kind of shtick. You really do care greatly about all the important things in life, and you understand that sometimes people just need a helping hand. And that the world, as John Kennedy said, doesn't start out fair. You have to make it that way.
The Nicole Sandler Show, live Monday through Thursdays at 10 a.m. Eastern, or podcast anytime at RadioOrNot.com.
All right, we are back. I'm Nicole Sandler, coming to you live at RadioOrNot.com, SoFloRadio.com, TalkRadio1.com, and ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. Lots of different ways to listen. All the links are on the website at RadioOrNot.com under the Listen Live or Watch Live tab. Just find the one that works for you. We're also podcast for free. Shortly after the show, the podcast goes up. It's available in all those usual outlets. We're on Stitcher. Lots of ways to listen. I hope you will. Especially now, because this is one of those stories. Look, the whole world or the whole country is preoccupied right now with the idiocy of Todd Akin, right? And yet the mainstream media is ignoring the story of Don Siegelman. This is a story that everybody should know about, and frankly, everybody should be outraged about. Don Siegelman was the governor of Alabama, actually a very popular Democratic governor. How shocking is that? I know, a Democrat, popular in Alabama. Well, I'm going to do a very short rundown here. Basically, Karl Rove and his cronies were not at all happy about the fact that Don Siegelman was a popular Democrat. And so they did everything possible to discredit him, to run him out of the races back in 2002 and then again in 2006. And finally, what they did was they set him up. And he is now really a political prisoner. Don Siegelman was, I think, framed. He was charged with bribery, something that, you know, is ridiculous because he took a political contribution. Well, you know what? Let's get Don Siegelman on the line. The bottom line is Don Siegelman is supposed to report back to prison on September 11th.
Good morning, Don Siegelman.
If something doesn't happen. Governor Siegelman, Nicole Sandler calling. Thanks so much for coming on with us again. Now, a lot of people who are listening now heard our interview on Friday. You joined me on the Randy Road Show, but I'm so happy that you could join us this morning because, as people know, that the show is on regular terrestrial commercial radio. are tightly formatted. We only had a few minutes to talk, and I think your story needs to be told in a way that people who are not familiar with what happened to you really know what happened. Because as horrible as it is, what was done to you, the fact that this happens in the United States of America today in 2012 is something that everybody needs to be aware of. So that we make sure not only that, that justice is served in your case, but this doesn't happen to anybody else. And the fact that it could happen to you, a very highly respected governor of the state of Alabama, just shows that this could happen to anybody. So Don Siegelman, again, as I was explaining right before I got you on the phone, if we don't do something, if there is a petition up, and I'll give this website out a number of times during our talk today, change.org/pardondon. If somebody doesn't step in from the White House to change this, you report back to jail on September 11th for the next 6 years?
That's right. Another way to get to the website is just donsiegelman.org. It's S-I-E-G-E-L-M-A-N, I before E.
Right.
As you explained on Friday,
right.
Some basic spelling tips. But let me just recap briefly for
Please.
your listeners, and then we can go into depth on some of these things. Because people always ask me, well, why would Karl Rove even care about you? But we have sworn testimony that Karl Rove directed the Department of Justice to, quote, pursue Don Siegelman. We know that Karl Rove's best friend was serving as my opponent's campaign manager while his wife, the George Bush-appointed Karl Rove-anointed prosecutor, was investigating and starting the indictment process against me, leaking stories to the newspapers to damage my chances for re-election. We know that I was brought to trial 1 month before my re-election in 2006, again by the wife of Karl Rove's best friend in Alabama. The list of Karl Rove fingerprints on this case goes on and on, and I'll be happy to go into that. We also know that Jack Abramoff, in his book recently published, admits that he spent $20 million of Indian casino money in Alabama, and that I was his top priority, and that he says Don Siegelman had to be stopped. He sent Grover Norquist in to do dirty work in Alabama as well in 1999 when I was trying to get the Alabama education lottery established so kids could go to college for free. You may remember, too, that it was Karl Rove's partner and a man who immediately went to work for Jack Abramoff, Dan Gans, who claimed credit for stealing my election in 2002. And it was Karl Rove's client, the Attorney General of Alabama, who stepped in and refused to allow us to have a hand recount of just one precinct where some 5,000 votes, my votes, went missing after midnight, after the polls were closed and the votes had been counted and I had been declared the winner by all the major CBS, ABC, NBC, CNN, and the rest. So people wonder why Karl Rove would be involved. In 1992, after the Bush-Quayle debacle and Clinton was elected, George Bush ran Karl Rove off. Karl Rove and his best friend Bill Canary moved to Alabama and set up shop here. They both married ladies. They both married women from Alabama. Karl Rove settled on the Gulf Coast at a place called Rosemary Beach, and he and his best friend, Bill Canary, started running campaigns to take over the Alabama Supreme Court, as Rove did in Texas. And they used the same tactics here on me as they did in Texas on Jim Hightower and others, and that is to leak information about investigations and that kind of thing to try to do damage to their opponents. But I started doing battle with Karl Rove in 1994 when they he tried to steal his first election, that of the state Supreme Court Chief Justice. And then we did battle again in 96 and 98 and 2000, 2002, and 2006. But that's basically the story of Karl Rove and his involvement in Alabama. But we know that Rove used the Department of Justice as a political weapon, as a tool to win elections. He even went so far as to fire Republican attorney, fire Republican U.S. attorneys who were not pursuing Democrats, like David Iglesias.
And let me step in here for a second, because this is another issue that people will remember, the whole U.S. attorney scandal. Usually, and we're speaking with Governor Don Siegelman, who's relating just an unbelievable story, but it is true. We remember that during the Bush administration, when a new administration comes in, the usual practice is they fire all the U.S. attorneys and replace them with their own people, as did George W. Bush when he came into office. But somewhere midway through his term, they realized that many of these U.S. attorneys were not doing their political bidding the way they wanted them to, so they fired a whole bunch of them who weren't, again, just doing what they politically wanted them to do, and replaced them with their own puppets, if you will. So this is where you came in, right?
Yeah, and in those states where the U.S. attorneys were doing what Rove and Bush wanted done, even if they lost cases, they were praised and given a pat on the back and were allowed to stay on. But if Republican U.S. attorneys did not do what they were expected to do politically, then they were fired and replaced with people who would pursue Democrats. And, you know, I found myself caught between Karl Rove and political operatives in Alabama who wanted me out of the way. Even a state Republican attorney general from Arizona, who was John McCain's deputy, I mean, the national campaign co-chairman, Grant Woods, said that they couldn't beat Siegelman fair and square, so they targeted him with this prosecution. Those are the words of a Republican attorney general from Arizona. The problem that I have now is that, I had a judge who either was selected or decided he wanted to take this case. He and I had had political battles, a major political battle back in 2002. And we tried to get him recused and failed. I faced a judge who had a grudge against me. And I now stand convicted of bribery as the only person going to jail ever in the history of the United States for raising money for an issue advocacy campaign. Wasn't raising money for my own campaign. I was raising money to establish free college education for all of Alabama's children, and where there was no self-enrichment scheme. I was convicted under a new standard where jurors were allowed to infer that there was an agreement rather than, you know, having, you know, proof beyond a reasonable doubt. They were able to, the judge allowed them to, quote, infer that there was an agreement. The guy that was the supposed briber, the contributor, had I reappointed to a board, a non-paying part-time board on which he had served through three previous governors. So I was the fourth governor in a row to appoint the CEO of a Fortune 500 company to a board on which he had served.
Oh my God!
For nearly 12 years.
Wow. That's an important point to make, because that I wasn't even aware of. So they accused you of accepting a bribe for a fund to help send underprivileged kids in Alabama to college. And the payoff was that he would donate to this fund and you would appoint him to this board, but he'd already served on the board.
Yeah, for 12 years through one Republican and two Democratic two Democratic governors, or no, two Republicans and one Democratic governor. But the so this is an unusual case for lots of reasons. The Rove and political connections, the fact that my opponent's campaign manager's wife was running the investigation while her husband was trying to defeat me, the the fact that this is the first case that anyone can identify in the history of the United States where somebody's being sent to prison for raising money for an issue advocacy campaign where there's no self-enrichment scheme. I am confident that we will win eventually. We had 113 former state attorneys general, both Republicans and Democrats, who said that, hey, this is not a crime in America. We had the top law, constitutional law professors from around the country weighing in with the Supreme Court, saying that the law is too vague. You can't send somebody to prison under these standards. There's got to be some quality and quantity of evidence required before you can convict somebody of a crime. The odd thing was, it wasn't against the law. Even if I did what they said I did, it wasn't against the law when I did it, and then they made it a crime during the course of the trial by allowing the jury to infer that there was an agreement.
Oh, my God.
So I feel confident. We've got the support of George Will, for goodness sakes,
right?
A conservative Pulitzer Prize-winning Republican columnist who said that until the Supreme Court hears the Siegelman case, or the underlying facts of the Siegelman case, that contributors and politicians, participate in politics at their peril, because prosecutors have unbridled discretion to pick and choose their targets. So it's a dangerous situation. And as you started this program, and as my daughter has said, who's going to be fighting for my freedom after I am locked up on September the 11th.
Amazing.
If this can happen to a governor, and I might say in a Fortune 500, contributor, it can happen. We had the resources, thankfully. I spent everything that I'd saved, but we had resources to go to court, to hire lawyers, to fight this thing. But, if you think about the guys on the girls on the street who are subject to being stopped or challenged by or targeted by the government, it's just overwhelming. And we've really got to get this stuff straightened out. I want to make one more comment, and I know I've been talking too much.
No, not at all. This is your forum here.
But Nicole, you said people don't believe that this kind of thing could happen. But we didn't believe that America could go to war under false pretenses of supposed weapons of mass destruction. We didn't believe that this country would allow torture as a means of interrogation, waterboarding. We didn't believe that we would see a country where our constitutional rights would be suspended indefinitely, because of the Patriot Act. There are things that go on, the covert assassinations, the killing without,
due process,
without any due process.
Right.
All of those things whittle away at what America stood for and what Americans still believe in. But we were and can be a proud country again, but we have got to, we've got to center ourselves back on our moral compass, and we are off course. We are off course, and it's not something that can't be corrected, but as you just stated, it is up to us, the people. We have got to do something about it, and I'm asking people to help me get out of prison. I don't want to stay in prison for 6.5 years.
God, no.
For something that never happened, something that wasn't against the law. I don't want to stay in prison for one more day because of Karl Rove's shenanigans or, the political manipulation of this case. But you know, so I am asking people to go to donsiegelman.org, Don Siegelman, SIEGELMAN.org, and there's a free Don button up on the right. Mm-hmm. If you go there, you can sign the petition to the president. But what we're hoping is that this becomes something more than just setting me free. It's got to be about, you know, it's not about what's left or right or Democrat or Republican. This is about what's right and wrong, and we've got to hopefully get the attention of the president so that if he is reelected, that he will also embark on doing things to you know, reset the moral compass of this country, both in, you know, from the Department of Justice standpoint, from freedom and liberty standpoint, and, you know, we've just got to keep moving trying to move the country back in the right direction.
Absolutely. Don Siegelman is with us. Again, the website, donsiegelman.org, I before E, S-I-E-G-E-L-M-A-N, and I'll have all the links up on my blog at radioornot.com after the show. A couple of things, one is, the whole premise of this case against you, were a political target. The fact is that they really set you up. I mean, even to the point where the so-called evidence against you was an assistant in the governor's office who claims that he saw this donor coming out with a check. Again, we need to reiterate that you were convicted of bribery, but no bribe took place. It was a political contribution. And today, I brought this up on Randy Rhoads' show on Friday with you. You know, today we're looking at someone like Sheldon Adelson, who was willing to spend $100 million to buy the White House for Mitt Romney. We know there's going to be some real quid pro quo there, where he wants whatever investigation into his foreign practices dropped. I mean, it's right there in black and white. How is that person not in jail and you are? I know that's sort of a rhetorical question, but it just begs for a real examination of what's going on in this country.
Well, it's, you know, there are two ways to look at this. One, there are real efforts to buy favors, mm-hmm. that are going on, and some of those are very clear in our face. And as you said, there is no investigation, there is no prosecution, there, you know, but then on the other hand, there's my case where the money didn't come to me. It was going to help raise, you know, funds for our kids to go to college.
Right.
And you know, the standard that they used for me was one that had never been used before. So, you know, again, I'm hopeful that people go online and sign the petition of the president, and this thing starts to grow exponentially and gets the White House's attention, and they do for me what they did for Ted Stevens at the beginning of their administration. Mm-hmm. But again, it's a bigger issue than just Don Siegelman. This is not just about me. This is about restoring justice and restoring our democracy and, putting our foot down and saying never again will we allow the Department of Justice to be used as a political weapon, as Karl Rove used it during the Bush administration.
Exactly. Now, I also mentioned at the beginning that, you know, when a new administration comes in, the standard operating procedure is they get rid of all the U.S. attorneys and install their own, even though Bush replaced some of his own appointees with others who would be more politically friendly to them. That's something the Obama administration never did. And one has to wonder why. Now, the other question is, just a month and a half ago, the Supreme Court refused to hear your case. So, you know, if you thought, all right, well, maybe, you know, we let this go through the courts and work its way up, eventually you'll get justice. What reason did the Supreme Court have to refuse hearing your case?
Well, they didn't give a reason, but my guess is, Nicole, that if they had said not guilty, or if they had said new trial, or if they had said the court below erred, it opens a lot of questions about Karl Rove, about the Bush administration, about the abuse of the Department of Justice. And my guess is that they just thought, wait, we'll just wait until there's another case that doesn't have all these other questions out there, because, you know, it would raise more questions. It would open Pandora's political box, and it would probably bite the judge, the prosecutors, the Department of Justice, Karl Rove, and a bunch of other people. And I think it was just too much for them, you know, too heavy of a burden for the Supreme Court to bear on this case. So my only hope of getting my personal injustice righted, and the only hope for drawing attention to what's wrong with this case, and hopefully getting the bigger picture of justice dealt with, is for people to go online to donsiegelman.org and punch that button that says Free Don, and let's try to get the president's attention.
Most definitely. Now, I got to ask where the media has been on this. I know Tom Hartman has been really good. In fact, I first learned of your case a few years ago from Tom Hartman. But where is television? Where is that corporate mainstream media? Why are they so silent on your case?
Well, you know, initially, after the progressive blogs and radio, you and Tom Hartman and, you know, other powerful, not mainstream, but powerful media got behind my case, then we began to see MSNBC, you know, Time Magazine, the New York Times, CBS's 60 Minutes on February 24th, 2008, which is also on this website, by the way, donsiegelman.org. I would recommend your listeners go to watch that 12-minute segment on 60 Minutes.
Absolutely.
Of February 24th, 2008, because it makes the connection and exposes Karl Rove's involvement in my case. But it was only because of the progressive media that we got mainstream media. Where are they now? That's a good question. We had a good article in the Washington Post a couple of Sundays ago, but, you know, I'm hopeful that that between now and September the 11th that we can stir up enough interest so that perhaps these, you know, some of the others who have covered my case will get back on it.
So now, Don Siegelman, now that the Supreme Court has said they're not going to hear your case, there's no more recourse via the court system, right? The only chance you have of not having to serve the next 6.5 years in prison is for the conviction to be vacated, to be pardoned or commuted, right? The sentence to be commuted.
That's essentially right. We've got one possible appeal that may come about in a motion for a new trial, but the government, the Department of Justice is opposing that, and it'll go back to the 11th Circuit, where we've not had such a good record on this case. So, as a practical matter, yes, the president's commutation or pardon is my only practical hope at this point.
Wow. Now, Don Siegelman again, Don Siegelman, SIEGELMAN.org is where you'll find all the information. There are over 100 former attorneys general from around the nation who have gotten on board and said, wait a minute, this is a travesty. This is a miscarriage of justice. This is wrong. Is there any way we can mobilize all of those very influential names and do something? I mean, I get the petition, but I mean, well, it seems like we should be able to do more here.
Well, yes, I mean, they are still willing to help. Actually, the number has now grown by one. There was another Republican who signed on the other day, so we're up to 114.
Wow.
Former state attorneys general, and they're supporting this cause. You know, I don't know what it's going to take to get the president's attention. You know, one would have thought that we would have gotten it a long time ago.
Yes.
So, you know, it's a struggle. We just have to keep fighting because, you know, we can't give up. We cannot allow these kinds of shenanigans to go on within our Department of Justice, because if it can happen to me, it can happen to anybody, and it will. This is not something that is going to be an isolated event. Now that they have lowered the standard, in essence, to an implied agreement, if bad prosecutors with a political vendetta, or prosecutors who want to silence a contributor, prosecutors who want to silence a particular politician, they can get an indictment off of just about any contribution that is made to a politician. They can prosecute the contributor and the politician. So, if this isn't corrected, it is going to change the face of American justice, and it's going to change our democracy, because people are going to be subject to the desires of prosecutors to pick and choose their targets.
Why hasn't Eric Holder acted on this?
I think my guess is Eric Holder came out of the Department of Justice. He has served with a lot of people in the Department of Justice. Because he's been there, he has a tendency to trust those people, even though there are still a lot of Bush holdovers in the Department of Justice. And I think that he has been reluctant to challenge the opinions of those people below him. And I think that's basically it. It's impossible for this case not to have gotten his personal attention.
Exactly. Yes, he's got to know what's going on with you. Now, and in my mind, the fact that they have done nothing is just unconscionable. And this is what I struggle with all the time. It's like, how can I bring myself to vote for Barack Obama, given all of the, your case, given, so much that he's been too silent on. And then all I can think is it's either going to be Obama and his administration in office come January for a second term, or it's going to be the Romney administration. And I hate that I have to resort to this. It's the lesser of two evils. But under a Romney administration, I think there will be no recourse for you, which is even worse. I mean, we will see, the Karl Rove system of government just become even more, acceptable, which is unacceptable.
Yeah, well, Rove served in, this is before your time, Nicole, but Rove served in 1972 in the Nixon White House under Don Segretti, who was he was a guy that kind of gave birth to dirty tricks at the White House level.
Sure.
And during that time, you may remember or may not, but they created something called the Plumbers Unit, and they had a couple of infamous guys go out and do political dirty tricks to kind of hurt their Democratic opponents. I think Rove, when he became part of the inner circle of the George W. Bush White House, he decided that rather than creating an ad hoc group to do these investigations and smear tactics, that he would just take over the Department of Justice. And so Rove was given credit, or took credit, for the appointment of nearly every U.S. attorney and federal judge during the four-year period that George Bush was president. I'm sorry, the 8 years that George Bush was president. And by doing that, he put them through a litmus test to make sure that they were the right people for the jobs. And as you noted, and we talked about during this program, if they didn't act the way Bush and Rove wanted them to, Rove replaced them and put people in who would march to the political drum that he was beating. That is a very dangerous thing for our democracy, for our constitutional rights, and for justice. And if Rove is allowed to get back in, it's going to add weight to those injustices and to the wrongs that will be committed. So I'm a firm believer that people have to vote for the best choice even though, it, you know, as you said, it may be, may not be the best choice in our own minds,
right,
but it's the best choice for the country.
And the best choice for the choices we, of the choices we have. And, you know, look, my hope is that all of a sudden we'll see the, you know, the hidden progressive in Obama come out in a second term when he doesn't have to worry about pandering to
yes,
the moderates,
yes,
and the middle of America, and all of a sudden, you know, he'll do the right thing. You know, I'm knocking on wood here. The bottom,
yep,
line is, a daughter of ISIS on Twitter just asked, how can we help? Letters, emails, phone calls. First thing is, go to donsiegelman.org, SIEGELMAN.org. It'll be up on my blog at radioornot.com after the show as well. Sign the petition. But what else? Can we bombard the White House? Can we give money?
Well,
I mean, what else will help you?
Well, you know, I would primarily get this out, get the word out to your friends and family and anybody you can through Facebook and Twitter and what other, what, you know, well, we're also, you know, trying to circulate paper petitions to, on the street and at conventions and getting signatures and having those sent back into to Birmingham to my brother, who will package them all up at the end of the day when we do some our petition to the president. But mainly right now, getting the word out to everybody that they need to sign this online petition.
Okay, that is the most important thing. And then whatever else we can do. I got to say, Don, you have inspired a lot of people who hadn't been involved in any kind of action before, who have been so outraged over what was done to you. And again, I said this on Randy's show, I'll say it again. This was done to you. You were targeted, you were set up, you were attacked, and you were wrongfully prosecuted. You've already spent 9 months in jail, right? What is that like?
Well, you know, I think my experience is a little different. But I was, you know, keep in mind that my conviction, I was governor.
Yes.
I've been in politics as Secretary of State, Attorney General, Lieutenant Governor, and Governor for about 25 years.
Amazing.
Never had a blemish on my record. Never accused of wrongdoing until Rove and his guys came after me. As soon as I was sentenced in the courtroom, I was taken out immediately, handcuffed. My legs were shackled, my chain put around my waist. I was put into a car and taken immediately to a maximum security prison, the oldest, worst prison in America, located in Georgia. I was put into solitary confinement for 3 weeks. And then taken to Oklahoma, where I was put in solitary confinement
again for
another week before I was released to the swamps of Louisiana, where it took my family over a 17-hour round trip to get to me to say hello. So for a month, nobody knew where I was. But yeah, I guess, you know, my point is, no one would want to, and I'm not whining, and I'm not asking for sympathy, but no one would want to go or suffer what my family has had to endure. I want to go back to 2002.
Okay.
Just for a minute, to put things further in perspective about why Karl Rove was interested in targeting and bringing me down. As the Republican from Arizona, the Attorney General, who was John McCain's national campaign chairman, said, Don Siegelman was a Democrat they couldn't beat, so they targeted him with this prosecution. In 2002, I was beating all of the top Republicans in the state, in a Republican state. I had won lieutenant governor and governor. I had defeated their top candidates, defeated an incumbent Republican governor to be elected in 1998. I was running for re-election in 2002. I was going to enter. Al Gore had decided not to run again in 2004. So I had been touted as a dark horse candidate by a Republican conservative business newsletter called the Kiplinger Letter in 2002. I was about to launch an effort in southern primaries to draw attention to George Bush's failed economic war policies and education policies. And I thought that that was what I needed to do to help, you know, focus attention on George W. Bush's failures. So I think your listeners can also see there was another reason why my election was stolen. There's no question about that. There was, again, the people given credit was, a woman who was the business partner of Karl Rove, and another one who went to work immediately for Jack Abramoff and a Tom DeLay related lobbying company. So the story is laden with political mystique, but the impact is something that's damaging to our democracy, damaging to our Constitution, and and damaging to our system of justice. So I'm asking your listeners to not only to help me, but to sign this petition so we can send a message to the president that this kind of thing cannot be allowed to go on anymore. We've got to get this straightened out.
Absolutely. This is a travesty. It's more than that. This is sickening. I the more I hear, and when I hear the way you were treated, I mean, look, I hate to say it. I thought when, you were sent to prison, it would have been like a club fed thing. The fact that they treated you the way they did, I'm sickened. Governor, I'm stunned that this can happen in this country, but people need to know that it does, and we need to stop it. DonSiegelman.org is the website. Go share it, sign the petition, and make sure everybody you know signs it. We've got to change this.
Well, Nicole, maybe we can talk again before I'm not able to talk again, and I will look forward to speaking to you. But again, thank you for this opportunity to be with you this morning and with your listeners. Folks, I don't have anybody to count on. Members of Congress aren't going to come to my rescue. The Department of Justice isn't going to come to my rescue. The only hope that I have for my personal freedom lies with you, those who are listening to this show. I've got to depend on you to sign this petition and to send a message to the president that, we want our country back. We want to restore justice, and we want to preserve our democracy.
Most definitely. Governor, I'm not going to let up on this, and I'm going to do everything I can to make sure everybody within the sound of my voice or the reach of my online presence gets involved. This is just so wrong. And on behalf of the country, I apologize for what's been done to you, and we need to fix it. Governor Don Siegelman, DonSiegelman.org, and it'll be up on my my blog at RadioOrNot.com, too, and everywhere. Thank you. And I will stay in touch, I promise.
Thanks so much, Nicole.
Take care.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
I don't know about you, but I am so sickened by the way this man was treated. This is a good, decent public servant. Here, from somebody on Twitter, this is from Incognito, spelled in a creative way. Don Siegelman, a public servant with principles and character. You think that's why they had to take him down? No, because this is the way the right wing of this nation operates. They lie, they cheat, they steal. And we need to turn things around. We need to make sure that that is not the modus operandi here. It's all groovy, says, now I'm crying and pissed. Yeah, sign the petition. The fast shortcut to the petition is change.org/pardondon. You don't have to worry about spelling. You don't have to worry about spelling it correctly. Pardon Don, change.org, pardon Don. Rarely am I speechless, and I've heard his story, but I'll tell you, this is the first time I heard how he was mistreated in prison, how he was sent into solitary confinement. I'm sorry, that's torture. I'm blown away. And on September 11th, interesting date they picked, he has to turn himself back in again to be mistreated even more. I'm stunned. We need to look. I'm sorry. I'm looking at the petition, and there aren't nearly enough signatures on there. It says thank you for 7,781 signatures in 11 days. That's not enough. If you haven't signed it, it's now up to 11,875. That's not enough. They need another 13,000. Actually, they need to get it up to 50,000 signatures in order to get the attention of the White House. So your goal right now is to get involved here. This is something, this is tangible. This, we can touch it. This is disgusting. So, wow. A decent, honest man in government. And because of that, he was targeted. There's not much worse in this country than that. Seriously. All right. I'm waiting for the Talk Radio News Service to call in. I know today it's Ellen Ratner signing now. Thank you, Gypsy Cat. If you haven't signed it yet and you're listening, if you're watching on Ustream, the URL is up there. But I'll tell you again, change.org/pardondon, PARDONDON. change.org/pardondon. What the hell are you waiting for? I'm absolutely sick.
I read the news today, oh boy.
All right, time now to check in for the latest news from the Talk Radio News Service, the talkradionews.com. I believe we have Ellen Ratner on the line today. Is that you?
Yeah, you do. It is me.
Hi. You know, I got to say, I know your brother is one of the people, I believe, working with Julian Assange. Do I have that right?
Yes. You have that correct.
Now, I know that when we spoke about this, the last time you and I spoke about this subject, it was like in June when you gave the story that the Supreme Court refused to hear Don Siegelman's appeal on bribery charges. And I explained to you that Don Siegelman was set up by Karl Rove. This is a man who was the governor of Alabama.
By the way, if you would like to talk to Governor Siegelman, he's just called me yesterday. He'd like to.
I just had him on the air for the whole last hour.
I'm
glad you spoke to him, but this is a case that the Center for Constitutional Rights, that your brother really should take up.
I don't disagree, but I'm a little sister. I don't have a lot of influence with him, but if somebody like you called the center and asked them, as a talk personality, it would make a big difference.
Okay, I certainly will. I definitely will, because I'll tell you, Don Siegelman's story.
And I would speak directly to the executive director and say that you have me on the air and that kind of thing.
Okay, I will do that. I if this can happen to this man who was a really good person, a good governor, who was just trying to do something to start a lottery system in the state of Alabama so that kids, underprivileged, low-income kids could go to college, and for that he was targeted and arrested and tried and convicted of bribery. And the story, what he told me about his time in prison, what they did to him. Do you know he was sent to like the worst, oldest, most dilapidated prisons in the nation and put in solitary confinement in the swamps of Alabama? I mean, I'm sickened by what's been done to this man.
I mean, it's totally disgusting, and people like Obama ought to pardon him.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. But, who knows
instead,
whether it's going to happen.
No, and instead, we're talking about forcible rape as opposed to legitimate rape. Are you kidding me?
I know. I mean, it's quite staggering, these guys.
It is. We
and
live...
You know what's happened is that, of course, Paul Ryan... co-authored a bill with this guy.
I know.
That's why they want him out. They want this story to go away.
Exactly, because they don't want the American people to realize that not only did they co-author a bill together, but the Sanctity of Human Life Act of 2009, which declares that a fertilized egg is entitled to the exact same legal rights as a human being.
It, Yeah, and human beings like Governor Siegelman aren't
right.
entitled to anything.
Right, but some girl who might, you know, a 13-year-old who might have been raped by an older family member, but because she didn't fight back and punch the guy, it's not a forcible rape. So, but you know, to make it even worse, the Republican platform that is now a work in progress actually has a provision in there that human life amendment, right? And no exception for rape or incest.
It boggles the mind.
Yep. It really does. And if the American
people... Well, what's happening is they're realizing they're losing with women very, very quickly
well,
over
there. Think?
And that's why they want this to go away. Not that I think they ever had it, but if whatever they had, they don't have anymore.
Now, from what I understand, the deadline for him to withdraw from the race in Missouri is today
it's
at 5 o'clock. Right?
That's
so
right.
He's got till 5 o'clock today. Now, it sounds like this guy Aiken, his ego is so big that he doesn't want to, but it sounds like the pressure is on.
Well, the pressure's on. They're saying they're not going to give any money to him.
Yeah.
But I think he doesn't care, maybe.
No. And that's the thing. And good, you know, and look, he won the Republican nomination in the state of Missouri. He needs to see it through to the end.
Well, yes, and this way Claire McCaskill will win. But, you know, I have to tell you this about Claire McCaskill. Look, I like her. She's a Democrat, et cetera. But she's been very weak on some social issues.
Oh, of course. Look, but, you know, the bottom line is she's also from the state of Missouri, which it's still, you know, the latest polls show it neck and neck. And if the state of Missouri is that, or Missouri, is that conservative that they would elect an idiot like this, I understand what she's got to do to get elected. Now, I wish she was a little more liberal, but maybe we can't get anybody liberal from the state of Missouri.
Right. That's the question.
Yeah.
And who knows?
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, you do have St. Louis. I'm not sure Missouri is as conservative as people think it is. I mean, Ohio often gets painted that way, and the great state of Ohio isn't.
Right. So, but do you think that maybe Claire McCaskill would be doing better in the polls if she were more progressive?
I actually do think so, because I think people feel, you know, people often vote for who they want in their living room, but they certainly vote that way for president.
Yep.
And I think people want somebody who they feel is being direct with them.
Yeah, well, and also, look, if you want the Republican, you're going to vote for the Republican, not the Republican light.
Exactly.
Yeah, I hear you. Well, that's why, you know, I say it all the time. These candidates, these Democrats who think they need to move to the center or move further to the right to get elected, no, you're going to turn off the people who would vote for you for doing the right thing here.
Exactly.
All right. So, Ellen, the president has taken a lot of criticism lately for not doing a presser with it, you know, the White House press corps or, you know, speaking to national media. He did it yesterday, huh?
Well, he did it yesterday. He did it for 20 minutes. They always know who they're going to call.
Yep.
It's not like he reaches into the press room and asks people a question.
Right.
It's really, I have to say, I'm pretty depressed about it.
Okay. I guess he wanted
to... But he did take questions,
yeah.
And so that was good, and he certainly responded on the Romney issues. He also talked about Syria, so that was interesting, and of course, what they basically said is they use chemical weapons, and that's it for Syria.
Okay.
Or they even moved the chemical weapons, and I think that's it for Syria.
All right. All right.
What we can do, and then also, I don't know if you know... But this morning, the Army Chief of Staff, the Joint Chiefs of Staff plane was assaulted by the Taliban, and they claim they have full capability of assaulting anything because they probably infiltrated all parts of the Army.
Right. No, right. I mean, you're talking about the, what are they called, the blue-on-green or the green-on-blue attacks?
Right, yeah, right.
You know, this is really frightening, where our troops are over in Afghanistan ostensibly training Afghanis to take over their own defense and protection. In the last couple of days, there have been a few of these where an Afghan civilian becomes an Afghan police officer, gets the gun, takes the gun, and then shoots the American soldiers who've been training them.
Exactly. And, you know, I remember when we had three embedded slots in the 2003 war, And Charlene spent a month in Jordan before, and she would run through the neighborhoods while the rest of the press sat behind and drank. And I talked to people, and they said to her, "You will not be able to tell friend from foe." And as we were leaving, I recall when I was leaving Iraq the first time in June of 2003, this was right before the insurgency started, right at the border, this guy said to us, "Is George Bush not know what he got himself into?"
Ay, ay, ay. Well, why don't we just get the hell out of there?
So, I mean, it's the same issue in Afghanistan.
Of course.
These tribal places, I mean, it's just ridiculous.
Right. It's crazy world. I mean, seriously, things are upside down and nuts.
Right. Yeah.
So, what else? I mean,
I got to tell you, these are the dark. Washington is cleaned out. It's the dog days of summer. I'm very worried about Governor Siegelman. I'd like to get him some help.
Yes, me too. Well, you know, did he sign the petition yet? I mean, that's the first thing we can do because 11,000 signatures are not enough.
Right. Now, there needs to be like 500,000 signatures.
Yes.
I may bring one to the conventions and get people to sign.
Oh, good. Yeah, change.org/pardondon is the easy link to the petition. But we need to get this done. I mean, I'm beside myself after that interview with him. I had him on Randy Rhoads' show last Friday, but you know the interviews on Randy's show are 10 to 12 minutes. So I had him on for a good 40 minutes on my show. And when you get into it, it's not only embarrassing.
Well, I hope you put that interview up, and if you do,
we
can link to it.
You got it. I will. I'm going to put it up in its own little video, its own little YouTube. I'm going to excerpt it, and because it needs to get out there.
Perfect.
All right. So I will send that to you this afternoon.
Okay.
Anything else?
And I'll be talking to you. Actually, tomorrow you speak to Congressman May, and then Victoria on Friday, and then we'll be at convention.
Awesome. All right. We'll talk to you then, Ellen Ratner.
You got it.
From the Talk Radio News Service at talkradionews.com. Thank you. All right. Well, that's a big change from Ellen, who in June, when she reported about the Supreme Court not, hearing Don Siegelman's case, not being familiar with it, to wanting to, get on it and help him. That's a big change. See? One step at a time. Change.org/pardondon. If you haven't done it yet, do it now. Like now. Got it now?
At goatsfortheoldgoat.com, you can buy a goat to fight hunger in South Sudan and help recently liberated slaves from the north come to their peaceful home in the south. We'll send you a certificate acknowledging your gift and a photo of your goat with its recipient upon delivery. Even better, you can make the donation in the name of your special someone as a present they'll never forget. So visit goatsfortheoldgoat.com today and help fight hunger this holiday season. That's goatsfortheoldgoat.com.
This is the Media Matters Minute. I'm Laura Keeter. Since Representative Todd Akin's inflammatory remarks that it is, quote, really rare for women subjected to, quote, legitimate rape to become pregnant, members of both major political parties have lined up to condemn his remarks, and some have even called for him to drop out of the Senate race in Missouri. But CNN contributors Dana Lesh and Eric Erickson, not so much. On The Dana Show, host and CNN contributor Dana Lesh attacked the GOP for urging Akin to drop out of the race.
He made a mistake. Is it a campaign-ending mistake? No, my gosh, people. The hyperbole is ridiculous.
CNN contributor Eric Erickson also jumped to deflect criticism of Representative Akin when he wrote, quote, Todd Akin was inarticulate. Some are now accusing him of being pro-rape. For this story and more, visit MediaMatters.org.
Come experience the next generation of progressive voices. Weekday nights on Nicole Sandler's primetime lineup at RadioOrNot.com. Liberate yourself with Filter Free Radio, hosted by Jacob Dean every Monday night.
It's just the system is broken. Bring it down. Bring it all down, right?
On Wednesday nights, take a sharp progressive turn and join Talking Left with Danielle and Shano.
All those Republicans are anti-capitalist.
All of a sudden. Well, no, they're just anti-Romney.
Exactly.
and it's interesting to watch the three-legged stool splinter.
Then let it all hang out both Tuesday and Friday nights on Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick.
You love the Constitution so much, but you hate the government, but you love the corporations. Where does that come from?
Tune in to the primetime Radio or Not lineup weekday nights at the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, radioornot.com.
I'm sorry, I just find the whole thing so ironic and so mind-bending, it's just ridiculous.
It's time once again for Fools on the...
Hey, kids, it's time for the political carnival and gotta laugh with the Nicole Sandler Show.
That was a whoopsie. I hit the wrong button. It's Tuesday, not Monday. Time for laughing. Hello?
Yes, you've reached the offices of Legitimacy, Inc.
Oh, boy. Okay, Legitimacy, Inc. sounds like they're way off mic.
Oh, gosh. Okay. How's this?
That's better.
Oh, good. Press 1 if you believe Todd Akin's wife never had a legitimate orgasm.
Oh, beep.
I got a hat tip that one to Rocky Mountain Mike. He allowed me to use his words. Okay. Press 2 if you believe the GOP is in legitimate disarray.
Beep, beep.
And press 3 if you believe Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan don't have a retroactively legitimate bone in their bodies.
Beep, beep, beep. I think they're legitimately stupid. I think they're so stupid. Look, the thing is, much as the McCain campaign didn't vet Sarah Palin, obviously the Romney campaign did not vet Paul Ryan. Had they would have known that he co-authored a bill, this personhood bill that is, you know, that outlaws abortion in any for any circumstance, rape, incest, whatever.
Yes, indeed. It's blastocyst Americans unite.
Yeah.
You know, and what's interesting is I just saw run across the Chiron on MSNBC that the GOP platform is embracing human life amendment,
yes,
right?
They are. In fact, I've got it right here. That section, let me just read to you. The human life amendment, quote, "We assert the sanctity of human life and affirm that the unborn child has a fundamental right to life which cannot be infringed. We support a human life amendment to the Constitution and endorse legislation to make clear that the 14th Amendment's protections apply to unborn children. We oppose using public revenues to promote or perform abortion or fund organizations which perform or advocate it, and will not fund or subsidize health care which includes abortion coverage. There is no explicit exception for rape or incest."
Exactly. So now Romney and Ryan say they, quote, you know, disagree or whatever they said, right, with Akin, yet they don't, are they going against their own party and themselves because they both said they're for personhood? I mean, it's so convoluted, and you're right. They need to vet themselves. They need to vet each other. They are unvetted. They are vetless.
They're vetless. Actually, they're just liars. It's any way the wind blows doesn't really matter, right?
Exactly.
To them. Right.
It's really pathetic.
They don't. Right.
These are the people who insist that we should trust them. Oh, just trust us about the tax returns. Oh, just trust us about, we'll come up with something for Medicare later. We'll tell you when we talk to Congress once we're in office. We're supposed to trust them when they can't, from hour to hour, stick to one talking point for their own campaigns, let alone represent the party.
Because it goes with the wind. It doesn't matter. They just, you know, the thing is, Paul Ryan has said over and over and over again that he is, you know, he is the most pro-life, you know, more pro-life than anybody. I mean, he is, and I hate the term because they're not pro-life. I'm pro-life, by the way. I'm all for life. I'm all for living people being allowed to live, being allowed to get the health care they need to stay alive. They're not. They're pro-fetus. They're love the fetus,
right,
hate the child. Because once that child is born, they don't give a shit. It's like, out of sight, out of mind. I don't care. It's out of the body. It's on its own.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. And God forbid, you know, you have a child born to a poor family that requires food stamps. Oh my God. You know, the other day on Twitter, some idiot tweeted me and said, you believe in abortion to me. You accuse me of believing in abortion. I thought that was the oddest choice of words. Just like you say, you're pro-life. Of course we're pro-life. Hello. We believe in life. I don't believe in abortion. I support a woman's right to choose if she wants to have or needs to have an abortion.
I support a woman's right to do what's right for her body and her family.
Exactly.
And a woman who is pregnant, first of all, and that you're talking about like rape, the day after, if that woman was impregnated by the piece of slime, rapist, criminal, miscreant piece of shit who raped her, that is it's a blastocyst. It's a zygote. It's not even a fetus. And that's right. Why the morning after pill should be legal. Should be available for any woman to get the next day. That's number one. Number two, before that fetus is viable on its own outside of the body, it is a fetus. It is an appendage of that woman's body. And that woman has the right to do whatever. If she doesn't think she is in a position to carry a pregnancy to term, to give birth, to have a child, or even mentally deal with carrying a pregnancy to term and putting a child up for adoption, that is her business. It is her body.
Absolutely. And I also don't, just as you said, it's an appendage. I really get like my backup when I hear them say the unborn child.
It's not a child.
If it's a cluster of cells or is unable to support itself, like you said, right. It's not a child. A child is a being that has already, is on this earth with us, not inside somebody's body, depending
right,
on
that has been
body.
Born. I mean, are they?
Yes.
Then why don't they, when a child is born, first of all, it's the birthday we celebrate, the day of its birth, the day it becomes a living, breathing human being on its own and not a parasite in the woman's body.
It is, yeah.
But it is a parasite. It is something that cannot exist outside of the body. And you know what? If you want to say, talk about the time when I believe, abortion maybe shouldn't be legal unless the mother's life is in danger, the day that child is viable outside the woman's body. But that's not right. What they're talking about. They're talking about that when it's a blastocyst, when it's a fertilized egg, that is the that it's a person at that point.
Yes, that it would enjoy the same constitutional status as a fully grown adult. It would enjoy any, quote, legal attributes enjoyed by adults.
Wow. Wow. No.
Can you give a fetus a gun? Because their Second Amendment remedy would be right. To shoot the mother. I mean, you can carry this to such insane extremes. And of course, we're talking about extremists, so why not do that? The party has gone so far to the right, and there's no reasonable left. It's become just this big battleground. You know, we've got these wars going on, these political wars. There's no longer any reasonableness or what's the word, rationale. I can't think of what word, you know.
Because it's not rational, because it's insane. And actually, the reason, as Ellen Ratner pointed out in our news segment, the reason the Republicans want this Aiken business to be done with so quickly is because Paul Ryan, this is Paul Ryan's belief.
Of course.
And they want to take the attention away. But Paul Ryan firmly believes in this personhood nonsense. Paul Ryan, was a co-author of this personhood bill, the Sanctity of Human Life Act of 2009. And here's how it reads. One, the Congress declares that, A, the right to life guaranteed by the Constitution is vested in each human being and is the paramount and most fundamental right of a person. B, the life of each human being begins with fertilization, cloning, or its functional equivalent, irrespective of sex, health, function, or disability, defect, stage of biological development, or condition of dependency, at which time every human being shall have all the legal and constitutional attributes and privileges of personhood. Oh my God.
Well, they gave corporations personhood. Why wouldn't they give a couple of cells personhood?
Yeah. Well,
I mean, they give an animate object. You know, why don't we start calling chairs people too? I mean, it's just insane.
It is insane. But I hate to say,
and they're not
it.
Going to be able to separate themselves from their own candidate. They may try to get rid of Aiken, but because as you've just said, and I've just said, that Paul Ryan is so entrenched in his own personhood support, they're not going to be able to back away from this now.
You're right. Well, let's hope not. We got to keep it alive, as we still, I hate to say it, need to keep alive Romney's tax issue.
Yes.
Mitt Romney, if you're not hiding anything, then show us your tax returns. If you've got nothing to hide, well, then it'll go away very quickly.
Yeah, this is just why, a couple of weeks ago, I believe it was, I think you and I talked about an article written by Brigham Young's great-great-granddaughter.
Right.
And in that article, as I recall, it said that given the status in the Mormon religion that Mitt Romney has, part of the Mormon thinking is that he does think of himself above other people. That's part of
right.
what they approve of. That's part of what they support in that religion. And so he believes he can get away with stuff because he holds himself above the rest of us. That's part of what he believes.
That's right. And again, he's never had to answer questions because they don't allow in the Mormon Church underlings to actually, you know, ask critical questions of bishops and stake precedents. So, you know, he's never had to justify his sense of entitlement. And it is entitlement.
See, that's the difference. When they say that Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security are entitlements, it gets my back up again because we pay into this sort of thing. And he, on the other hand, has a sense of entitlement where everything was given to him.
Right.
You know, and he hasn't paid in as much, if at all, as we have. So there's a huge difference, and I wish that would be talked about more, and of course it isn't. You know, the news media tends to focus in on one little aspect of one topic rather than broaden
right.
out
right.
And explain the character of a man and show, you know, the context of the man rather than just one specific.
No, I hear you. Well, you know, that's our job, I guess, because the media
yeah.
won't do it. You know, I got to say, Ted Rall, the cartoonist and author Ted Rall, has a new cartoon out. At the top, it says, Paul Ryan says he won't take away your Social Security or Medicare if you're already old. How are people under 55 supposed to avoid a future of dumpster diving? And mm-hmm. then it's got, you know, a guy with like a police guy in riot gear with a night stick about ready to come down on this guy, and two people talking. One says, press on wrinkles, gobs of aging cream, fake driver's license, security, young. And the other guy says, no, pre-old, as the cop with the billy club is about to come down on him. I guess that's what I am now, is pre-old.
You're pre-old.
I'm pre-old.
I want to know why they're so busy convincing everybody who's 65 and older how they're safe. So, in you know, by process
even 55
of
and older.
55 I'm 50, and older. I'm sorry, 55 right. and older. My typo of my tongue.
Yeah.
And yet, if he's so busy trying to convince everybody, don't worry, then those people under 55...
Worry.
Okay. Oh,
because
what
here's
is
the
that?
Thing. If we, you know, if what they're offering to people in my age group, 55 and younger, and I'm not there by much, it's so good, then why don't they give that to the seniors now if it's such
and
a good deal?
Exactly. Why are they? They're frantically, you know, trying to convince the people who qualify. Oh, no. We're good. You can vote for us, right? But are the rest of the people standing around who are under 55, are they getting this, that
right.
they're not being addressed, that it's okay
well, this
for
is
everybody?
Another thing I'm going to, you know, be sure to point out very regularly. All right. Gotta Laugh is with us. You have a new blunt, and this one is for Paul Ryan, yes?
It is. I wanted people on Twitter to ask him questions.
Okay.
Just ask him, because they never answer them anyway.
Right.
So maybe the questions themselves could stir up a little thought, a little trouble, you know. So that's what this is.
Okay, so this latest Blunt webisode is called Answer This, Paul Ryan. Here we go.
I'll tell you what I think.
Eddie has just become a man.
Mitt Romney chose Eddie Monster to be his GOP running mate.
Isn't that wonderful, Eddie?
Mitt chose the Eddie Budget Monster.
What am I going to do?
To be honest, his choices weren't great.
He
wants to take Medicare and blow it up. That should go over well in Florida.
You're the meanest kid I ever knew.
Mitt Romney chose Eddie Monster.
That's a dirty trick.
To be VP.
Okay, I guess I got it.
Running mate.
Every now and then, I'm known to make a mistake.
Roll Call and The Hill and Politico all featuring articles right now about Republicans freaking out about what Paul Ryan's addition to the ticket means for every other Republican on the ballot in November.
Paul Ryan, here's my question for you. Are you going to continue to raise taxes for the middle class while you continue to lower taxes for the rich.
During the Bush-Cheney era, Mr. Ryan, as a member of Congress, voted for all of the things in the George W. Bush era that cost a lot of money and that were not paid for at all.
Congressman Ryan, ultimately your budget would cut 91% of non-defense discretionary spending. Now, your great-grandfather made his fortune by building roads and railroads with government money. I'm curious, how can you justify pulling up the ladder of opportunity for the next generation, not only of entrepreneurs, but of poor families that rely on food stamps and Medicaid, in order to have the opportunities that you were given thanks to government?
I grew up reading Ayn Rand, and it taught me quite a bit about who I am and what my value systems are and what my beliefs are. The reason I got involved in public service, by and large, if I had to credit one thinker, one person, it would be Ayn Rand. It inspired me so much that it's required reading in my office for all my interns and my staff.
Why do you hate America? Why are you such an un-American thinker running for VP? Doesn't make any sense.
So doctrinaire Republican Paul Ryan has shaped his thinking, has based his career on a Russian atheist writer who says she doesn't think the family is a necessary unit of society.
It's something I completely disagree with. It's an atheistic philosophy.
Paul Ryan, quest for idiocy. Do you want to control all vaginas in America, including birth control, health care, abortion, etc.? Do you want to give an egg personhood so they have more rights than a woman? Do you worship Ayn Rand and rich people? And are you in charge of a de facto death panel that's voted to end Medicare as we know it? Mr. Ryan, have you no shame?
Imagine if Barack Obama had been a devoted follower of a Russian atheist who insists that the family unit is unnecessary.
It's something I completely disagree with. It's an atheistic philosophy.
Congressman Paul Ryan, now presumptive vice presidential nominee Paul Ryan, co-sponsored a bill in the House that is a federal version of the Personhood Amendment, the abortion and hormonal birth control ban, the same one that even Mississippi voters rejected last fall. How'd you like it for the whole country?
Hi, Congressman Ryan. I received your lovely Christmas card last year. My only question is, was there supposed to be a voucher attached?
Congressman Ryan has also supported a federal version of Bob McDonnell's Virginia forced ultrasound bill. He sponsored a federal bill to force women seeking an abortion to undergo a medical procedure, regardless of whether or not they want it, regardless of whether or not their doctor thinks it's the right decision, but just because the government says you have to.
Representative Ryan, you and Governor Romney, if elected, intend to repeal the Affordable Care Act and turn Medicare into a voucher system. Can you ensure senior citizens that they will not deny coverage by private insurance companies for pre-existing conditions or charge exorbitant rates if they have one?
The conversation in Florida tonight instead is, I wonder if Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan are seriously going to kill Medicare if they win the White House in November.
Mr. Ryan, is the reason you're okay with eliminating Medicare the fact that your father, your grandfather, and your great-grandfather never lived to age 60, so you figure that you will never need it, so you don't care about anybody else having it?
That's right. Paul Ryan, a Republican anti-abortion fanatic, has until very recently been publicly proclaiming his philosophical hero to be a woman who was a relentless champion of a woman's right to choose.
It's something I completely disagree with.
One, if you plan for Medicare for people under 55 is so damn good, why aren't you putting your own mother on it? And two, you know all those Social Security benefits that put you through college? You're gonna give them back? Or are you just gonna take mine?
The Romney campaign is going to have to sort out whether they are for or against Paul Ryan. It's a great plan. Actually, I'm going to be running on my own plan. My plan is very similar to Paul Ryan's plan. You know, I'm sure there are lots of differences between my plan and Paul Ryan's plan. Paul Ryan is absolutely right on. Our budgets are very different.
I'd just like to know, if you actually succeed in replacing Medicare with the voucher system, which do you think would be better for the American public? I'm kind of torn between Nine Lives and Friskies, but I also hear that Fancy Feast has a better aftertaste. So get back to me on that, okay? Thanks.
The most common reactions to Ryan ranged from gnawing apprehension to hair-on-fire anger that Romney has practically ceded the election.
Rep. Ryan, why did you vote to prevent the Department of Justice from interfering in state voter ID laws which violate the Voting Rights Act?
Right-wing hero Ayn Rand couldn't stand Ronald Reagan.
It's something I completely disagree with.
Dude, it's not an urban legend if that's you on tape saying it about yourself. Repeatedly, for years, and with feeling.
It's something I completely disagree with.
One, I hear you're a Rage Against the Machine fan. If that's true, what's your favorite Rage Against the Machine song? Question two, have you ever crowd surfed? Question three, are you doing what they told you?
Are you?
Stop it.
And why are you running for vice president when all you want to do is destroy this country?
So I guess now is as good a time as any to welcome Congressman Ultrasound to the Republican ticket.
I'm Mitt Romney, and I approve this message.
Whatever it was.
Mitt Romney chose Eddie Monster to be his GOP running mate.
Isn't that wonderful, Eddie?
Mitt chose the Eddie Budget Monster.
What am I going to do?
That's pretty much it.
All right, Laffy, great job. Another blunt.
Thank you. That was a fun one to do. I have to admit there was so much to draw from, and everybody was saying just really good, clear, you know, he's nuts. It was just wonderful to look for clips.
Mm-hmm. I'm still a bit surprised, honestly, by this choice of Paul Ryan as the running mate again, because they seem to just not pay attention to general wisdom, because general wisdom tells you it's what prompted that Etch-a-Sketch comment from Eric Fernstrom, the question from our buddy John Fugel, saying, you know, during the primary, you know, Mitt Romney had to move way to the right in order to, you know, get the primary votes. But general wisdom says for the general, he has to move back to the center in order to, you know, court the independents. And instead, he picks, you know, the rightest of the right, crazy wingnut nut job Paul Ryan.
Yeah, I don't know. I think either he panicked because he was just going straight downhill right before he made the announcement.
Well, that's true.
Or he decided, yeah, I'm going to be the far right guy and I'm going to suddenly get, you know, a spark of interest, and then I'm going to get these people to come out and vote. Those are the people that are most likely to be the ones to go to the polls because they're fired up, you know. So he's hoping, because otherwise they would have all slept in.
Yeah. Now, you know, back that obviously you produced that before the whole kerfuffle over Todd Akin came to light. But so last night or yesterday afternoon, I guess last night, Todd Akin stood up Piers Morgan. So Piers Morgan was left with the empty chair thing.
I didn't know that.
Yes. But didn't Lawrence O'Donnell once do the empty chair interview? I guess Piers Morgan was lowered to that point last night. But so I played a little bit of this earlier, but Mike Huckabee, can we just talk about what a perfect example of hypocrisy that Mike Huckabee is? He claims to be, you know, a man of God. Wasn't he a preacher of some sort? This guy lies continually. Mm-hmm. And then he's almost excusing Todd Akin last night or yesterday afternoon, whenever his show was on, in which he sort of put a word in his mouth.
Congressman Akin, thank you for joining me, because I know it's a very difficult day for you, but you're getting hammered out there, and I wanted to give you an opportunity to explain what did you mean by the comment that you made yesterday.
Well, Mike, I really appreciate your program and everything you stand for, and I really appreciate your giving me a chance to try to make this thing right, because I've really made a couple of serious mistakes here that were just wrong, and I need to apologize for those. First, I might say that I've always been committed to pro-life, and it was because I didn't want to harm the most vulnerable. But likewise, I care deeply, you know, for the victims of people who've been raped.
Yeah.
And they're equally vulnerable. And a rape is equally tragic. And I made that statement in error. Let me be clear. Rape is never legitimate. It's an evil act. It's committed by violent predators. I used the wrong words in the wrong way. What I said was ill-conceived, and it was wrong. And for that, I apologize.
Mm.
Now, I'm a dad of two daughters.
I'm a bad, bad man.
For sexual predators. And I've always had a compassionate heart for the victims of
really?
Sexual assault.
Sure you have.
And I've even known some women who have been raped. And I know that it is a terrible, terrible thing, and that those consequences extend many, many, many years later. And I also know that people do become pregnant from rape. And
really? Because that's not what you said the other day.
It wasn't the case. It does happen.
Really?
And it's also
wow.
terrible, particularly the most terrible of all. And I just want to apologize to those that I've hurt, because, as I said, I have spoken in error, and I wanted to get that straight right off the bat.
Spoken in error.
Well, there has been a firestorm from this, and I think one of the problems that maybe accelerated it was the use of the term legitimate.
You think?
What did you mean by legitimate rape?
How bad I'll
Were you attempting
it?
To say forcible
rape? Oh, because forcible rape is okay? Really?
Where did that come from?
Well, I was talking about forcible rape, and it was
because that was in that
word.
Bill that I was a sponsor of, the forcible rape, which went
but
down.
But you do realize, I mean, there are rapes that result in pregnancy.
That's
you realize
right.
that, right?
I know that. And in fact, I have known people who've been raped. I don't know any who've been raped and it turned out to be in pregnancy.
Really?
But I know that happens, too.
Oh, it does happen.
Okay, so that's one of the things that people have said, is that it is medically incorrect to say that if you are raped that you won't have a pregnancy, because obviously there are a number of people. Ethel Waters, for example, was the result.
Wait, I want to get to the
forcible rape.
You know, not that all of this isn't egregious on Huckabee's part,
James,
but I want
to
get to this
back
one other part.
In the 1970s, he leads a large Christian organization.
Oh my God,
he himself was the result of a forcible rape. And
a forcible rape,
you know,
as
so
opposed to just
happens,
rape.
And yet, even from those horrible, horrible tragedies of rape, which are inexcusable and indefensible, life has come. And sometimes, you know, those people are able to do extraordinary things.
Oh, so don't you dare abort.
Didn't
you know,
want to just scream through that
oh
whole,
my God,
the whole
thing.
Monologue?
I mean,
that was just unbelievable. So he's saying that even though there are horrible tragedies, that women suffer and there's a violence against them that make them that traumatize them for the rest of their lives. At least they produce admirable human beings that
right.
do good things.
Didn't somebody say, you know, like make lemonade or something like that?
Yes. You know, first of all that compassion he felt toward women,
mm-hmm.
he says he feels toward women. How much more contradictory can you get? I feel for you, but you're going to be forced to carry the baby
right.
To term. It's just mind-boggling. Now, also remember that Mike Huckabee pardoned a convicted rapist
yep.
who went out to rape and murder at least one other woman
right.
after
yes,
he pardoned
yep.
him.
Yep.
And he was warned about this. He was warned by other women that this guy was probably going to go out and do more harm to more women. Also, forcible rape, the definition of rape is that you're doing, it's against your will. That's
right,
forced.
But they want to put something in there. Again, this was that bill that Todd Akin and Paul Ryan were both co-sponsors of
right.
to redefine rape.
Yes.
And it would only, you know, federal funds could only be used if it was for an abortion, if it was a forcible rape. That means if you
right.
were drugged, you know, by some man who, and then passed out and he raped you while you were unconscious because you didn't fight back, that's not forcible rape. If you are a child, you know, a 12 or a 13-year-old girl who gets pregnant by some older person who coerces her into it and she thinks she's in love or something, well, that's not forcible. Really?
Or if you're instructed, you know, people have been instructed at don't fight back. They'll kill
I'll
you.
Kill you.
Just let
right.
it happen.
If you don't fight back, well, then it's not a forcible rape.
Right. That's so much
believable.
Yeah. It really is. And that just makes it easier to narrow down the illegality, you know, on their side, illegalities of abortion. That's their way of outlawing abortion.
Yes.
And that's the only reason they're saying that. And I wish more people would come out and concentrate on that rather than just say, well, they're trying to redefine. You know, the reason they're trying to redefine is to outlaw abortion and forms of birth control. It's look what they're doing to women. Hello, women out there, GOP women, what's wrong with you?
I don't know.
Where are
I,
they? I, why aren't they fighting? How if their wives were to be raped, would they want their wives to carry a baby to term? The rapist baby to term? Is that what they'd want for their wives?
I don't know. Or their daughters. Their daughters.
Yes. Unbelievable. You know, if you don't have kids, the bond between you and a child is amazing. I mean, before I ever had kids, I couldn't imagine what kind of love you have for your child.
Yep.
It's unimaginable.
But can you imagine every time you look at your child, you think of the rape that got you pregnant? I mean, I can't. No, I'm sorry. Yeah. It's really sickening.
And the act is violent. It doesn't matter if it made someone get bruised. It's violent to do something against somebody's will, period. End of story. For them to parse it this way, for them to show that there'd be any discernible difference between because somebody gets a punch in the face and somebody or somebody fights back and somebody doesn't. Why isn't the whole – I don't understand why everybody in this country – unless you're absolutely brain dead, which I guess defines the GOP at this point, why they wouldn't stand up and audibly fight this, audibly say, are you guys insane?
Right. I don't know. I don't know. None of it makes any sense to me.
Things are more traumatic. Things that don't even rise to the awful level of rape are traumatic.
Of course.
Rape, I can't even imagine.
And what it does, I mean, thankfully I've never been raped. But look, I remember when I think I was 15, and because we weren't driving yet, down here in Florida, and a group of us were meeting on Halloween to go trick-or-treating together. And two friends of mine they had one bicycle between them. So one was walking while the other was riding, and they were taking turns on the bicycle. And while one was riding, I guess she was ahead of the other one. This girl, Denise, was walking, and she went by this area where there were bushes, and a guy came out of the bushes and pulled her in and I believe held a knife to her throat and raped her. Okay. She was 15. And I remember how this rocked our world, our 15-year-old world. Now, thank God she didn't get pregnant from that. But if she had, and there was a law in place that said she couldn't abort that fetus, I look at my daughter now who's 13 and think, God forbid anything like this ever happened to her. You know, but to compound it and to add another basically rape onto it to make her carry this being in her body for 9 months and then give birth to it, I mean, that's punishment in and of itself.
Well, look how they're reducing the value of women, your baby machines. It doesn't matter how you get pregnant, your baby machines, because that zygote matters more than you do. And the more power we can have over you, the better we feel. You know, I wasn't ever raped, thank God, but I came what I thought was close when I trusted a guy when I was in college. Turned out he was a baseball star later in life. But at that time, he was playing baseball at UCLA. And he tried some stuff. We were alone in a car, and I trusted him. And he started to overpower me, and I was terrified. I literally, you could just feel the terror just go, just shoot through your body. It's just this odd feeling. Luckily, he stopped. I said no enough times, and he stopped, and I was relieved, and I was shaking. Now, that's just a minor incident.
Right.
You know, he never hurt me. He did try to overpower me. He literally, you know, he took my arms and tried to stop me from moving. But then he stopped. And if it went further, I can't imagine how awful that would have been. So just the emotional insult to women.
Yes. Tell them for the rest of your, you know, the 9 months, you've got to carry this thing in your body, which every second will remind you of that assault. It's absolutely stunning. And it's amazing to me that this guy, Todd Akin, you know, it's always interesting to me as I stand back and look at like the media climate and the coverage of politics that this would, that this is what got them so bent out of shape. I mean, when you think about it, this whole personhood amendment that Ryan and Akin proposed, it's just as egregious. What, because he didn't say the word?
Right.
It's stunning. Now, President Obama walked into the White House briefing room yesterday and took a few questions. One of them was on this.
Comments that the Missouri Senate candidate, Republican Todd Akin, made on rape and abortion. Wondered if you think those views represent the views of the Republican Party in general. They've been denounced by your own rival and other Republicans. Are they an outlier or are they representatives?
Well, let me first of all say the views expressed were offensive. Rape is rape.
Rape is rape.
And the idea that we should be parsing and qualifying and slicing what types of rape we're talking about doesn't make sense to the American people, and certainly doesn't make sense to me. So what I think these comments do underscore is why we shouldn't have a bunch of politicians, a majority of whom are men, making healthcare decisions on behalf of women. And so although these particular comments have led Governor Romney and other Republicans to distance themselves, I think the underlying notion that we should be making decisions on behalf of women for their healthcare decisions, or qualifying forcible rape versus non-forcible rape, I think those are broader issues, and that is a significant difference in approach between me and the other party. But I don't think that they would agree with the senator from Missouri in terms of his statement, which was way out there.
Should he drop out of the race?
He was nominated by the Republicans.
It got cut off there, but then the reporter asked him, should he drop out of the race? And Obama says, well, he was nominated by the Republican Party there, so I think his opinion is the same as mine. He's the nominee. Let him run.
Oh, yeah. I was glad he said what he said. Rape is rape. There is no discernible difference. For anyone to believe that there is, or to suggest that there is, what would happen if, guys get raped?
Yes, they do, except they don't get pregnant. Can you imagine if men got pregnant? Can you imagine?
And if women made the rules and dictated to men what they should do with their bodies and their emotions?
No.
Can you tell I'm a little upset?
Yes. Yeah, it would be a whole different ball game.
Literally a ball game.
Yes. Yes, no shit. Now, I got to say, and then Akin goes out and does an ad. And I played this before, but I got to play it again. This is just insane. This is his TV ad. Now, remember, if you didn't know this guy is running for the Senate, you would never know it. But here's the ad. It's just him full screen, talking into the camera.
I'm Todd Akin, and I approve this message. Rape is an evil act. I used the wrong words in the wrong way, and for that I apologize. As the father of two daughters, I want tough justice for predators. I have a compassionate heart for the victims of sexual assault, and I pray for them. The fact is, rape can lead to pregnancy. The truth is, rape has many victims. The mistake I made was in the words I said, not in the heart I hold. I ask for your forgiveness.
Oh, my God. Now, I got to say, David Schuster tweeted a little while ago, Midwest voters will show mercy to folks who genuinely ask for forgiveness. Akin's ad is well done, regrettably. Look, if a woman can listen to that bit of backtracking and think, oh, I trust him, he really didn't mean it, then she's a fucking idiot.
You know, this is just like when Rush Limbaugh said slut, and then Romney said, well, I wouldn't have used that word. It's not the
right
word. It's
no,
the intent.
It's your belief. It's
yeah.
Your belief system that's flawed. Mm-hmm. It's everything about it. Everything.
The word wouldn't
stands
have come
for.
Out if he hadn't believed what he was saying.
Exactly.
I mean, the word, yeah, replace it with another word. The point is that is how you want everyone to live. You want everyone to believe what you said. That's what the United States should become. People who think there are legitimate rapes and illegitimate rapes, or whatever, fake rapes and real rapes and fantasy rapes and Disney rapes. I mean, who the hell knows what he's talking about? But that's what he believes.
Yeah. No, I
so
hear you.
He can apologize to the camera all he wants. People with half a brain will understand that was a bunch of BS. And as David Schuster pointed out, unfortunately, yes, people hear somebody who sounds sincere and they say, yeah, oh, yeah, okay, okay, we'll give them a pass.
Right, yeah, I don't think so. Yeah. A couple of other quick things, because, oh, wow, we're running out of time here. We remember this weekend to great fanfare, yes, that Paul Ryan, you know, took his mom along as a prop. I guess it's better than a baby with Down syndrome. Anyway, this time he took her to, the Villages, which is outside of Ocala, Florida, very right-wing community. Also has the highest concentration of sexually transmitted diseases than anywhere else in the nation, just in case you were wondering. I think anywhere else in the world, actually. Those seniors have to do something to pass the time. Good thing they can't get pregnant, huh? Anyway, yeah. But I didn't know about this. Yes.
It's just one sentence. That, you know, I'm reading this long LA Times article about this whole thing at the Villages. And in this long article, there's a paragraph with a sentence that said, while they were, you know, all the supporters were jammed into this, what they call town squares, and they have happy hour dances, and they have this and that.
They do.
And they call it, you know, they said this is a double-edged reputation as the Disney World of the Cialis set. And then they say, open air bars at the Ryan event began pouring before 8 a.m. with 14-ounce margaritas going for $2.75.
Oh,
Chick-fil-A stand did a brisker business, however.
They were pouring mixed drinks beginning before 8 a.m.
Before 8 a.m. So here they are plying the elderly with alcohol in the sun, which can, of course, give them heat stroke and dehydration and cause them to pass out and get seriously ill. So I'm thinking, well, it's a good thing they have Medicare, yeah.
You know, and I also remember I saw part of it, and I saw Paul Ryan go, did you see that? Did you see that? Medics, I guess somebody passed out.
Indeed. They were probably drinking. And because, you know you have to get drunk to listen to him speak anyway.
Yes. Unreal. Unreal. You know what? And on that, we're gonna have to go. Because we're just about out of time. Laffy, I want to ask you, I'm going to pull out the segment of the interview with Don Siegelman and put it in its own video. And will you post the link to that petition and even that video of the interview so people hear, and his website, donsiegelman.org, on the political carnival?
I used to write about him all the time. I can't access my archives on that for some reason. So, yes,
please
I absolutely
again.
Will. Please DM me the,
I will.
The link.
I absolutely will, because, listen, we got to help this guy. The story of what happened to him, how he was treated in prison, where you would think he's a former governor, at least if they're going to lock him up, they're going to put him in Club Fed. No. They basically tortured this guy, and he's supposed to go back on September 11th.
Because he was a threat. Political threat.
Right. He's a political prisoner. It's really sickening. DonSiegelman.org or change.org/pardondon. All right. Got a laugh. Find her at thepoliticalcarnival.net. Thank you, Laffy.
Thank you.
All right. We'll talk to you next week, and I'll see you on the Twitters. And you will be back here tomorrow, as usual, same time, same place, radioornot.com. Thanks for listening. And good luck to Ron, who's getting bypass surgery tomorrow morning. See you back here soon.